understand what's Christmas really about.
Presents. I suppose.
I wasn't afraid of that.
Is he on his way? And you confirmed sighting of the shiny red nose? Okay, good. I'm up here. I'm waiting.
Oh. Hey there.
Oh, what am I doing up here? So, I'm waiting on Santa Claus because I need to talk with him about Christmas. I think Christmas has devolved into something we didn't intend for it to. And just between you and me, I think it's become a fetish.
You want to know what happens to your gifts? They all come to me. In your garbage. You see what I'm saying? In your garbage!
Rather than the sexual connotation we currently associate it with, fetish originally referred to spiritual objects believed to be imbued with special properties, especially those used by West African peoples in the 17th century. In his 1988 dissertation on the word's history, William Pietz explored this early use of the term. Another author commenting on his work said, Pietz shows that the fetish as a concept was elaborated to demonize the supposedly arbitrary attachment of West Africans to material objects. The European subject was constituted in opposition to a demonized fetishism through the disavowal of the object. Fetish was used to describe the mysterious, inherent spiritual value these objects held, but also arose from a colonialized sense of objectivity, stemming from a feeling of cultural superiority. So when Marx uses the term, he is referring to what he believes is an inferior way previous political economists viewed the value of commodities. Now, in my video on Black Friday, I left out an important point about commodities, which is that they not only exist to satisfy a need or desire, but also to be traded. In this way, something like air or water is not a commodity, nor is the fruit that you eat from your garden. However, oxygen tanks, bottled water, and the fruit that you sell from your garden are commodities. To use terms from the last video, a commodity will have both a use and exchange value, whereas something that is not a commodity, such as air, will only have a use value. Fetishization, then, is a form of essentialization, attributing to a thing natural inherent qualities or characteristics which aren't really there. Video essays abound with examples of fetishization in our culture. Another example of fetishization comes from the idea of the divine woman. Here, the desire to be a relatable person gets wrapped up and packaged in this ideal, which portrays the essence of women as divine beings worthy of worship, but not ones able to partake in society. The illusory quality of commodities, much like the mystical nature of the divine woman, seems flattering, but in reducing a group of things or people to one inherent attribute, it fails to consider the complexity of those things. As Halsey, the human, becomes a distant, unrelatable god, commodity, the thing, becomes its own mystical, illusory god, and we seek to worship it by devoting egregious amounts of time and energy towards it at the expense of other people. To be clear, commodity fetishism is not a preoccupation with consumerism, a tendency in Western culture. Rather, this tendency is a byproduct of the fetishization of commodities. Let's look at one specific example of fetishization of a commodity, the cell phone. Many would consider it a wonder of modern technology, and it forms the cornerstone of Western citizens' lives. We wake up to it, we communicate with other people with it, we use it to learn new things, we use it for entertainment, we spend hours scrolling on it for seemingly no reason other than to pass the time. It gives us access to members of our community specialized in emergency services. It keeps track of the time and the weather for us. Yet how often do we stop and think about the people who work to make our phones or the resources mined to put it together? This is our modern day fetish. So in a capitalist society, commodity fetishism becomes a lens through which we view the objects around us. This fetishization results in an obscuring of value. What would our lives look like without these commodities? What would I be doing here without
youtube.com.
When we confuse our values like this, it becomes hard to know what we stand for. We say we value the environment, yet we throw so much of what we come into contact with and use in the trash. Some rightly point to billionaires' hypocritical stance on climate change while using private jets for transportation. We believe in fair working conditions for all, but our eyes light up at the iPhone 14 ad on the screen of our iPhone 13. The problem is that capitalism tends to approach value from an individual's perspective rather than a collective one. Commodity fetishism runs so deep, though, as the foundation of our society that it's hard to imagine life without commodities, a feeling which oil companies take advantage of in arguing for a slow shift in our societal paradigm. Now, Marx doesn't really say that commodity fetishism is X. Rather, he uses the historical use of fetish to invoke an understanding of the commodity as an illusion of value, something we see as having worth within the atoms that make the thing up. This hides the true social reality of the commodity, which is given value by labor and resources. Consumerism provides an answer to our search for meaning by providing us with a value to work for in the form of commodities. Instead of connecting with our work on a personal or inspirational level, the majority of people work to buy goods and services. Unfortunately, we can't really escape the era we live in. Capitalism will continue to paint consumerism onto our lives. And honestly, it's hard to say if some of the commodities which I hold dear would ever have existed were it not for the current state of capitalism in our society today. Nevertheless, this doesn't mean we should continue to promote capitalism as an ideal foundation. Instead, we should look to one that prioritizes the well-being of all and the planet as a whole. So what would this have looked like in The Grinch? The 20-aught movie, How the Grinch Stole Christmas, even more so than the original, centers around this conflict of commodity fetishism. The Whos are presented as Christmas-loving beings who express their joy by buying presents for one another. Holiday spirit is defined by the amount and extravagance of ornamentation. The Grinch, ostracized by the Who for not quite understanding the seemingly inherent aspect of their culture, seeks to share his misery with them by taking away what he believes they love most: presents, holiday meals, and decorations. The turning point comes when the Grinch realizes that in stealing all this from them, he still hasn't taken away their love for Christmas. It's at this point that Kavan Kincannon, in an essay about commodification in The Grinch, states that the anti-capitalist narrative gets subsumed into the larger capitalist narrative. The story ends with the Grinch returning all the Who's presents and decorations, and him being awarded with the honor of carving the roast beast. As Kincannon points out, the Grinch now believes in the moreness of Christmas and can now celebrate it like everyone else.
Means a little bit more.
But what exactly is this moreness? It seems the story is trying to tell us the whole time that the true meaning of Christmas is not the presents, decorations, and holiday meals, but rather family, love, and a community coming together. So can the Who have their roast beast and eat it too? What Kincannon is getting at is to truly challenge the place of consumerism in the meaning of Christmas. The story should have subverted the role of the material objects in the story's ending. As he put it, can we envision a Christmas that truly is more than just consumption? In an effort to do so, let's imagine two alternative endings to the movie. Instead of the Grinch going Hulk mode and saving the sleigh, let's imagine he's only able to save Cindy Lou. Mr. Grinch, still feeling moved to provide gifts to the Who, comes up with a plan to search through the trash heap and repurpose thrown out items into new for the Who. This idea actually comes from a comment by MahoganyBennett7151 on a Wisecrack video covering The Grinch. Instead of assimilating into the Who's consumer culture, the Grinch and the Who forge a society more focused on each other, actualized by the sacrifice of the commodity. An even more radical ending is proposed by Kincannon himself. Rather than outside forces destroying the commodity, in this case the Who, enlightened by members of their own community and the Grinch's actions, take it upon themselves to destroy the commodities while simultaneously welcoming the Grinch into their community. In this ending, it becomes clear that the commodities truly do not factor into the Who's decision to welcome the Grinch into their community, and also shows they recognize their past mistreatment of him. At one point in his essay, Concannon comments on Slavoj Žižek's interpretation of the role of the Holy Spirit in Christianity. The Spirit is the collective human response that says that there remain yet things to fight for, even if we have lost the assurance that there is a God on our side who will guarantee that good wins over evil. Even if we destroy the commodity and capitalism at the foundation of our society, we can rest assured that there will still be ways for us to find meaning in our lives through the act of living more communally. In preparing for this video, I knew I wanted to have these lights to build a certain ambiance, and I also knew I would have to get a DVD copy of The Grinch 2000 to cut scenes from. While it would have been simpler for me to go out and buy these things myself, in the spirit of leaning towards my community, I reached out to a friend for the lights and decided to borrow the DVD from the library. Well, okay, so I actually didn't borrow the DVD from the library because there's like six libraries around me and they all had this DVD on hold, but so I bought the DVD and then I donated it to my library so that more people could watch the movie. It's pretty good. So the Who live in a world that reflects our own, where they've decided their fate lies within the system of capitalism. Our story, however, continues to unfold and we have the choice to follow a new path. So how does a Christmas unfetishized appear? Maybe it starts with used presents for cheer. Or maybe it's time set aside for letter writing, rather than another trashed Christmas tie for tying. However the season may appear to us new, it's certainly not Walmart we should be looking to.